In HBO Max's original series Peacemaker, visionary director James Gunn takes us deep into the lives of some truly violent American vigilantes. But what did it take to bring his vision to life? And who were the artisans responsible for taking inspiration from the comics page and making these heroes real?
I'm Tiffany Smith, and today we are checking out some of the newest arrivals at the Warner Brothers archive, the props and costumes from Peacemaker. So how did it all come together? Well, let's find out on the Archive Unboxed. Warner Brothers Archive, there are untold numbers of costumes, sets, and props, each with their own secrets known only to the artisans who made them. Fortunately for us, we have got the key costumes from Peacemaker here at the Archive, and we're gonna get a closer look than ever before. You just have to pose like that while you're looking at them. We spoke with costume designer Shay Cunliffe about bringing these characters to life on the new series.
Working on a show like Peacemaker, I feel like is kind of rare. One, because you have a lead actor that literally will wear his costume everywhere. And it's a show that James Gunn put together, and he has such a vision for what he wanted this show to be. So what was it like coming into this show and working with a director like James, who had such a clear idea of what he wanted Peacemaker to be?
It was interesting from start to finish because we were in COVID times. Mm-hmm. I met him on a Zoom interview. We had all our design discussions over Zoom. He had managed to create this entire series in his living room without leaving the house.
While the rest of us are like learning to roller skate or doing all kinds of silly things, James is like, I'm gonna create a whole show, we're gonna make this happen.
We had weekly design meetings the whole way through it, mm-hmm. where everyone, special effects, visual effects, art department, people doing the cars, locations, me, we all, over a Zoom meeting, shared our screen for it to say where we were up to. These are the original Peacemaker comic mm-hmm. books, which were given to me by our wonderful production designer, Lisa Soper. And they were just a mood inspiration. We had them pinned up everywhere to get in the vibe. But then we had to show the studio where we were going. Mm-hmm. So we created lookbooks. This is the one that the art department, again, very...
Which starts out right in the front. We've got the tidy whities or like a little bit of
James
yellow.
Loves, yeah. That was a huge stunt challenge, actually. Like when James said, I've written it that he's wearing tighty whities for a huge sequence. Mm-hmm. I'm like, but it's freezing. We're shooting it at night. It's Vancouver in January. He's going to go out a window. Like,
please tell me you put warmers in them.
It was a hellish challenge, and I think James was very good at saying, like, oh, John's cool, he'll handle it.
And he did. He was up for the challenge.
The thinking, I think, for James is that it's a kind of magical realism.
Doing the costume, how many mm-hmm. of them did you need to have to do an entire series?
I think we ended up with about 20 Peacemaker costumes made, and they were like 6 weeks to make one, really, by the time all the stages. We had a sort of Peacemaker Little Elves factory going in Vancouver.
This is your first kind of genre stepping into superhero world.
I'm aware that they're very complex and detailed costumes. They're a whole other level. My first thing was to get hold of the fabulous costume designer, Judiana Makovsky, who designed the original. And she said, you know, it's true, you aren't gonna know lots of things. You'll find out, you'll know by the time you finish.
Yeah.
But then when I got up to Vancouver, I had a workroom simultaneously working. I'd sent them the hero costume. I'd sourced the fabrics and sent it to them. Those simple white pants. Mm-hmm. So I learned that they were a special, very heavy twill with stretch that come from a fabric supplier in Yorkshire, in England. So I get hold of them, and they had just this many yards left. And
you're like, all of them are for us.
After it came in, we had to get it all over-dyed because it was too white. Mm-hmm. And then it went to a screen printer who puts all the texture in. It's sort of rubberized printing on top of it, mm-hmm. which gives it its life. Mm-hmm. This gives it a dimension.
So the Peacemaker costume was one you said you inherited, but mm-hmm. some of the other costumes for this show, you got to do from the ground up?
Peter Safran, the producer, and James Gunn had already talked to Film Illusions, which is run by an incredible artist, Russ Shinkle, about what they would need. And he had had his illustrators start to throw out ideas to them. Mm-hmm. So I approached it really as a designer in the way I'm used to, which is just looking at something and saying, I might change that or that. This was one of the early concept sketches mm-hmm. for Vigilante, but it seemed to me, referring to the earliest costume, it had much more of a through line and a slightly more vibrant feeling to it. So we ended up getting to that point where I sort of said, let's continue this all on through. Yeah, unlike Peacemaker, doesn't have a factory giving him his costumes. So we sort of cut up the fabric and stitched it up as if with every battle. There was no one else but himself, so we clumsily repaired it. This one, when I started with Film Illusions, they had gone quite far into the design thing. I think I'd looked at it and said we should add some detail, so this started being added. But it struck me as just way too dark, because I knew it was all going to be shot at night in a mm-hmm. forest, or at least when we meet the character. And so it was a great collaboration. There's a lot of fine points that I don't think an audience knows anything about. But that's a huge part of what creating a costume is after the kind of great sketch is done.
You can't have a show like this without having the big bad. So let's talk about the White Dragon and the costuming and going from comic book to what we have over there.
When Robert Patrick was first cast, we knew where we were heading, but they got the body mold of his body to get going, and then they realized that we had to make him even buffer than he really is. Then there's a bodysuit with rubberized muscles that they've cast from these that they've sewn onto an underbody suit.
He looks very excited about
it. he's a charming and hilarious man. The earliest White Dragons were a little underpanty. Mm-hmm. And after the very first full costume was made and we all looked at pictures, I think it was James Gunn who said, I'm not crazy about that area. And so I sort of went into hyperdrive, like thinking about alternate.
Now that you say that, it's all I can look at.
No, sorry, I should. No.
What made you want to get into costume design?
I was sort of not happy with my job, and I was thinking, what do I love? I give this advice now to young people. Like, if you don't know what direction you should go, and think what you would do at the weekend. I would go to a fabric store. I would make something. I used to make all my own clothes till I had to do it for a living, and then it was slightly.
Then you're like, I'll just buy it.
Yes. And then I love stories, because I think costume designers all are as interested in the storytelling as the costume. Mm-hmm. It's the pleasure of a character and a story arc, and how the costume helps tell that. Mm-hmm. So I thought, well, what combines all of that? And I realized it was costume design.
Deep in the archive, there is a room known to only the most elite archivists. It's home to every bat cowl, Spartan helmet, and alien mask. But the latest arrival has me thinking the future is helmets. For Peacemaker, at least 9 different helmets were manufactured by production designer Lisa Soper and forged by prop master David Dowling's team. From the hero helmet, to the Waterworld helmet, to the dirty X-ray helmet.
Okay, so this is a very special room where some iconic headwear?
Yeah, let's say that.
Stays?
Obviously, it's been taken over by Peacemaker at this point, which we're very excited for. Basically, the helmets that we're seeing here are part of a partnership between Lisa Soper, who was the production designer, and David Dowling, who was the prop master. So Lisa got all these names for helmets, basically. I think James Gunn was just writing down like random words, you know, like Ichiban, Waterworld, what, like figure
Toilet
out what
bowl.
That means. Yeah. So he asked for like, whatever, 6 or 7. Helmet suggestions, she gives him 60 variations.
Oh,
it's
wow.
insane. And some of them, like she admitted, like went too big, right? She comes from this animation background. Like, you've never seen someone so excited to design.
Yeah.
Lisa basically got the name Ichiban from James Gunn and was like, what do I do with this?
Yeah. You know?
But she's looking itchy. scratchy. She starts thinking of burrs from like the forest, you know?
Definitely not where my brain would go, but okay.
Not me either, but this is the type of design process yeah. she goes to, and all of a sudden we've got a helmet that's got all these spikes on it, and who knows what he's supposed to use it for, but it's still the coolest looking thing in the world.
I mean, if he's running at me and tries to headbutt with that
right.
thing, you don't want to be near that.
Who knows what the Peacemaker can do? So she comes up with all these designs, they hone in on the ones that they want, mm-hmm. and then David Dowling takes over. He's the prop master on the show. Mm-hmm. They borrow from the archive an original helmet from the film to reverse engineer how they made those. Mm-hmm. They decide that those are gonna be too heavy and too expensive. They made them out of their nickel and copper plated.
Oh my gosh.
So they're heavy, they're real metal to yeah. get this chrome effect.
Yeah.
So they're trying to make a billion of them for a TV show, make them lighter, make them cheaper.
And be able to do more stunts, and he's definitely spending a lot more time
exactly.
in the helmet as well.
They eventually found this company that does a like plastic coating. So they sent all the helmets down, all pre-polished, ready to go, and 7 days back, they get all the helmets and they look perfect.
It's crazy because you look at it and you're like, this is metal, and then you touch it and you're like.
The cool thing about this too, there are metal pieces. These blue strips are aluminum that's been tinted blue. All this too, this was done 2 days before shooting. He had like a weekend to come in. All of a sudden, James is like, it'd be cool if we had a pop of color on the sonic boom for the pilot, blah, blah, yeah. blah. So David takes him away, comes up with these strips and some way to make the gold here around the dove
yeah,
and brings it back to set on Monday.
Okay, so obviously there's gonna be a lot of stunts happening, all kinds of crazy stuff. They don't just pop this helmet on his head and he stays. How do they secure it? How does it stay together?
I love this, because it's a hidden seam, right? These are two-piece helmets, all of these. And it's a hidden seam here in the ridge. It has magnets, but it's also got this elastic strip that you can see. And that is so that John can put it on and off himself. Whereas this one, this is the X-ray helmet.
Okay.
And this one doesn't have the elastic, but you can see that row of magnets on the front uh-huh. there. And even this one probably had some sort of lighting effect in it too. And that's what this leftover wiring is for in there. Yeah, it's very cool. And for all these variations that Lisa designed, she talked about they have to pass the squint test. Mm-hmm. So at any point, whatever she adds to it or takes away or whatever variations she puts on it, you have to be able to squint and go like, that's Peacemaker. That's yeah. that's the basic idea of what you're looking
you're
at.
Like,
and I think all these kind of fall into that.
Yes.
Right, right.
Done.
So even the one behind you here, this is the underwater world. It's very Atlantean, right? You know, yep. like very tied into the DC universe.
Yep.
But it's still got that ridge, it's still got that toilet bowl look, like you're saying. So when you squint, you kind of lose the fin and you see the Peacemaker.
It feels very much like, you know, those games you'd play when you were a kid where you're like, circle the thing that's a little bit different
exactly.
on each of these.
Exactly. One of these things is not yeah. like the other, totally.
Yeah. But you know what I would like to do?
What's up?
Try one of them on.
Naturally. Okay, sure. Do you want to go a little rock and roll with it? Do you want to do the itchy bomb?
Yes.
Cool.
This is why I do this show, so I can try on all the props and costumes.
All right, so if you hold the front
okay.
plate.
Okay. Magnetized time.
Yes.
That am I good. In?
Yeah. She look good?
I feel very badass.
Oh, that
also,
awesome.
I have the same size head as John Cena.
Yeah, you can be the Peacemaker now.
I don't know if that's a good thing because I'm much shorter and smaller than him. So if we have the same size head, there might be a problem.
I say go with it. It looks really cool.
I feel very cool. I also feel like immediately when you put it on, you've just got to do those dance moves, right?
Sure.
You're doing them with me too, right? Because I can't see. I don't have good peripheral.
Totally doing them with you.
Where are you? Where are your moves? I'm done. Well, there you have it. The DC Universe is breaking out of the big screen and on to HBO Max in all of its weird and wild glory. I have had so much fun checking out the props and costumes from Peacemaker with you. And if you want to find out what other secrets lie in these hallowed halls, well, you'll have to find out next time on The Archive Unboxed. Do you really want to, do you really want to taste it? Costumes from Peacemaker and more in person? Check them out exclusively at the Warner Brothers Studio Tour Hollywood.
Nolan.